Welcome to the Band of Brothers. We meet each Friday morning at 6:30 at the First Baptist Church in Garden City. Our guests have spent some time this morning greeting each other and enjoying a hot breakfast. Now let's join Pastor Kenny Grant for today's Bible study.
Well, Exodus chapter number 12. Exodus chapter number 12. And we are coming down to the end of this chapter where the Bible tells us at verse number 37 that the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth. They left the Nile Delta. And the Bible tells us about how many there were. You remember now? The lamb had been slain. The blood had been applied. The lamb had been eaten. God has passed through in judgment. God has passed over in mercy. And now they were to come out. Remember how they ate that lamb, that roasted lamb with bitter herbs and unleavened bread? All of that is a picture, right? We spoke about that at some length. Now they're coming out. They had to eat that lamb, remember, with their loins girded. They had to eat that lamb with their shoes on their feet. They had to eat that lamb with their staff in their hand. What does all this speak of? The journey involved. There was a certain urgency in leaving Egypt. There was a certain urgency to move away from there, to put it in the rearview mirror, right? And the whole idea of the Passover and the unleavened bread. And remember now, for us, that's symbolic. Right? The blood have been applied. We are Christians now. So there is the idea, there's this journey before us. Our loins ought to be girded. In fact, Peter talks about girding up the loins of our mind. We ought to be fit for traveling. Our shoes on our feet, our staff in our hands, bespeaks the fact that we are pilgrims and we are strangers. This was a great mass movement of people coming out of Egypt. And the Bible says they had gone for probably about 25 miles or so. And notice what it says here. There were about 600,000 on foot that were men besides children. So now they say nothing about women. It's not counting the children. So sometimes when we talk about the number of people who came out of Egypt, sometimes you hear numbers like 2.5 million, 3 million, 3.5 million people. Nobody knows for sure. But if you just talk about the men who were on foot, not talking about the ones who were on donkeys and riding other things, and the older men who were non-ambulatory, couldn't move, they had to ride something in carts and all of that. Not counting them, just 600,000 men on foot. So if you couple that with the women that age who were able to move about, you know, right there you're at 1.2. If you talk about the children that families might have, you remember Moses had 2 siblings, so if we talk about all the siblings, maybe if the average family were 3 people, the average family, you know, who knows, we're up into 2.5-3 million people, 600,000 men alone. There was a point where we know the women outnumbered the men because the boy babies were thrown to the crocodiles for a while. We don't know how long that all happened, right? So I don't know how many little boys would, you know, there was a generation where there were just more women than men. And usually that's how it is, right? I would imagine that as slaves, men worked more rigorously and had harder labor. And the truth of the matter is, men die before women. So my point is, there could have been more women than men, but 600,000 men gives us a number of upwards of 3 million people, perhaps. A mass movement of people coming out of Egypt. This is no small thing here. It just shows you the power of God. It shows you how the God who brought them out and who would take them through, the God who would lead them out of Egypt, was the God who's to provide for them. This speaks of the glory of God. And in fact, notice what it says here. It says a mixed multitude came out with them, verse number 38. Who were these people? I'm convinced that there were maybe other slaves from other nations. There were Egyptians. You remember in the seventh plague of hellfire, there were some of Pharaoh's servants who were obeying the voice of Moses at this time. Moses said, hey, listen. God said, hey, listen, tell those who want their livestock to live and their servants to live to put them in bonds because there's going to be hellfire. And the Bible says some of Pharaoh's servants hearkened back in chapter number 9. Those who hearkened, they were spared. Those who didn't, they suffered loss. Who was this mixed multitude? Bunch of, they call them the rabble, but they came out. They got out while the getting was good. I'm catching the first thing smoking. Right? Well, I'm not staying back. God has shown himself to be God in delivering his people, in destroying Egypt. And they said, we're going with you. Now, they would be a problem. That mixed multitude would be a murmuring problem. That mixed multitude would... And by the way, it was enough of them to have an influence. Because you get to Numbers 11, you hear about that mixed multitude again. And that mixed multitude were complaining and wanting to go back to Egypt. And we missed the leeks and the garlic and the cucumbers and all of that. And it spread. It was a contagion of complaining and murmuring. So that mixed multitude was a considerable number. But I love that because it talks about the mixed multitude, which bespeaks the grace of God, by the way. You know what that tells me? Anybody could have came out. That's the grace of God, isn't it? The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to what? All men. This says, hey, any of them could have come out. It's not whether they could or couldn't. It's whether they would or wouldn't. But a mixed multitude, some said, hey, we believe. And God showed his grace to Gentiles or to the nations or to the heathen nations, just like he did to Israel. In fact, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Jebusites, all of those who possessed the land of Canaan, God gave them room to repent. They didn't. Of course, their iniquity was filled and God brought judgment to them and displaced them and gave Israel their land. By the way, God gave Israel their land. So who does the land belong to? It belongs to the one God gives it to because God is the owner. We are only possessors. God is the owner who has a right to give what he wants to whomever he wants. So he said, I gave it to you for a while and they send away their day of grace, and God displaced them and gave it to Israel. And he had promised Abraham 400 and something years ago, maybe 500 something years ago, that he would do it. This is why we call the book of Exodus book of redemption, because God is redeeming his promise. God is making good on his promise. God is bringing his people out, and the God who brought them out is going to do what? Take them in. It didn't have to take 40 years. It did take 40 years, but it didn't have to take 40 years. But God was bringing them out, that mixed multitude, and millions of people. And by the way, the Bible says he brought them all out here, notice, with them flocks and herds and even very much cattle. Can you just imagine this? I hope y'all believe the Bible. I believe it. Just, 3.5 million people with flocks and herds and all of that. Now, what a movement. And again, these were not simply refugees, that is, people with no home, people who are displaced. No, no, no. They come out as pilgrims and strangers. Now, the Bible says in 1 Peter that we are to abstain from the, worldly lusts, right, as pilgrims and strangers. I've tried to explain to you that a pilgrim is simply a person who is on their way home. They have a home and they are on their way home. We call the pilgrims who left England coming to America, we call them pilgrims. Why? Because America was their new home. They were on their way to the new home. It's not like they didn't have a home. They had a home. We're strangers in the sense that we are away from home. So we are strangers and we are pilgrims. Strangers in the sense that we are not home yet. pilgrims in the sense that that's where we're going. And these people were pilgrims and strangers. And they came out with all of these flocks and herds and all of this stuff that Moses refused to leave in that fourth compromise, the compromise of stewardship. Said, no, we've got to bring all these things out because a lot of this stuff was going to be sacrificed to the God who gave it to them in the first place. And they baked unleavened bread cakes or unleavened cakes. Remember what, come on class, now are y'all out there this morning? What does unleavened bread speak of? Sinlessness, right? The whole idea, unleavened bread. Leaven always speaks of sin and its influence. Yeast that causes the loaf to what? Swell, to rise. And that's a picture of sin, just a little. A little yeast will leaven the whole lump. And so this unleavened bread, and God is saying over and over to make sure that all leaven is put away and no leaven in the bread. He's saying, hey, miss, listen, I deal with sin very seriously. Right? And so the Bible says here, they bake unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt. And remember how they were thrust out. Hey, leave. You got your hat. Get your coat. Go. Right? They're slave labor now. They're thrusting them out, just like God said. And God told them, you're not going to leave empty-handed. So they leave with all that God gave them. They said, the Bible says they went and asked for their wages, basically. Remunerations. They had been cheated. They had been robbed. They'd been stolen from. Said, give us. They had, you know, they slave labor. Give us our wages. And the Bible says God gave favor to them, and the Egyptians gave them whatever they asked. Paid them to leave. And they left. And so here now, the Bible says they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry. That's why he says you eat this when the death angel comes over. You eat it. You have your staff in your hand. You have your loins girded. Have your bags packed, as it were. Shoes, you have your traveling shoes on. They were thrust out. Neither had they prepared for them any victuals. I love this. No preparations. God did the preparations. God says, hey, the only preparation you do is just get your sandals and your staff and gird your loins. And then God says, I'll provide for you. I love this when it says they had prepared for themselves. They hadn't prepared any victuals or any, what they say on the Beverly Hills, victuals. That's where that comes from. Victuals, food. They didn't prepare any. I love this because, listen, they were a group this group was stranded upon God. Think about that. Stranded upon God. That's a good place to be. When you're stranded upon the omnipotent arm of God. No resource, no recourse. Just God. But hey, don't feel sorry for them. There may be somebody in here who feel like you have nothing but God. You're okay. You know the problem exists for those of us who feel like we have other options. That's where our difficulties come in. I watch football and they talk about the quarterback, his first option, his second option, his third option. You know, many Christians, we feel like we've got options in life. We don't live with this sense of desperation, but they were in a good place, whether they felt like it or not. It doesn't feel good to the flesh to be stranded upon God. But they were in a good place. They were desperate. That's the breeding ground for miracles. Yeah, that's the breeding ground. You find the people who have seen a mighty touch of God, a mighty move of God in the Bible. They were all had one thing in common: desperation. Whether it's a woman who had gynecological issues for 12 years, spent all her money, no resource, no recourse, and she presses her way through, though ceremonially unclean, I'm going to see Jesus, and if I could but touch the hem of his garment. Desperate. whether it's 10 lepers put away from mom and dad and brothers and sisters and wives and sons and daughters and living just in a communal situation, just them 10, they beg, they cry out, have mercy on us. And Jesus says, go show yourself to the priest. Desperate. Oh, blind Bartimaeus, been blind. He says, what's all that scuffling I hear? They say, Jesus is passing by. Oh, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Hey, man, calm down. He's coming. Hey! That's the song. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art what? Calling. Do not pass me by. Desperation. Jairus says, I've got a 12-year-old daughter, been the joy of my life. She's laid on the bed, grievously sick. Jesus says, I'll come and heal her. Hey, on the way, they said, hey, she's dead. Well, no, he gets to the house, she's dead. Jesus put them all out, went in there, raised her up. These were desperate parents. I'm just saying over and over and over, right? It's the desperate who see the hand of God. Yeah, yeah. And I know this is a problem. This is a problem in the church. We don't sense our great need of God. We live in a Laodicean church age where we are rich and increase with goods and have need of nothing. Not knowing the real spiritual condition of our souls. The truth of the matter is we are all desperate. But some of us know it. Amen? And that's an awakening work of the Holy Spirit of God. I know that. The Holy Spirit of God is the one who's going to have to really show us our great need. That's why it is he in John chapter number 16 who says he convicts the world of sin and of righteousness and of what? Judgment. We don't sense it ourselves. It takes the Holy Spirit of God. And if God doesn't do it, we would go headlong into hell apart from knowing our need for a Savior, that our sins are egregious to God. There's a great need of righteousness that only God provides. The Holy Spirit of God who does that work in our life. The Holy Spirit of God is the one who shows us and prompts us that there is a judgment to flee. The wrath of God to flee. That's his work. Well, they were stranded upon God. I call it a good place to be. And the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years. Now, you'll find that number 430 used again when it's talking about their stay. 430 years is used again in Galatians chapter number 3, verse 17. And Paul uses the number that is used right here when he's writing in Galatians chapter number 3. But when God talked to Abraham back in chapter number 15, you remember he said that they were going to stay. Abraham's seed was going to go into this land who's going to evilly entreat them. He used the figure of 400 years. Stephen over in Acts chapter number 7. When he preached, he called it 400 years. Was it 400 or 430? It doesn't matter. Don't throw away your Bible. I find people, oh, that's a contradiction. Throw away the Bible. The Bible doesn't contradict itself. It just contradicts you. That's the problem. That's why. Don't throw away your Bible. God can use round numbers. So when God says 400, and it's 430. That's to be relaxed. God knows exactly what it was. You know, he said on the day of Pentecost, about 3,000. Now, why he say about 3,000? Did he not know? He knew. He just threw out a round number. So I'm just saying 400 years, 430 years, round number. But this Bible does say in the very day, indicating that it's 430 years. Oh, God said to Abraham, they'd be there for 400 years. Stephen quoted 400 years. It's like we say 2,000 people died on 9/11. It was not 2,000. It was specifically, and I don't remember the number. We say 3,000, but it was not 3,000. We say 3,000. So here it says, verse 41, and it came to pass at the end of 430 years, even the selfsame day, it came to pass that all the hosts, like armies of the Lord, went out from the land of Egypt. And I love it that he calls them armies again, because it denotes that not only were they were pilgrims and strangers, but they were warriors. There was a ragtag looking crowd now that call themselves warriors. You don't go off to war with your wives and your children and the babies and your pots and pans and rolling pins. But there was a bunch. You know what? God was with them. They were an army. And guess who was going to, whose battle it was? The battle was the Lord's. But same thing with us. We move through, and the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We don't fight with the armament that the world provides. It's not great military might. We do our fighting on our knees. We do our fighting in unconventional ways. So they were stranded upon God, and they came out as armies, as hosts. And God calls himself the, what, Lord of hosts. We're part of God's army. Now, we act more like a romper room sometimes, but we are soldiers. And it's onward. We're moving. We're on a journey, right? And we're going through, what, hostile territory. And there's warfare. And we can expect it. And in this world, we can expect warfare on our journey. In fact, the Bible says over in chapter number 13, you'll see over there, the Bible says they went out by ranks. It was not just a Chinese fire drill. It was like an army's going out, and tribes and all of that. They went out orderly, and God led them. Right? God works in order. He does. Right? The first thing you see when the Spirit of God working, that's why. I mean, when you see the Spirit of God working, what he does, he's always bringing cosmos out of chaos. First time you hear him mention, he's brooding over the face of the water in Genesis chapter number 3. He's bringing all of that disorder into order. There's the dividing of light and darkness and the water and the land, the firmament, land from the sky. He's bringing things into order, chaos to cosmos. And so God is a God of order. And they came out that way. Right? Notice verse number 42. It is a night to be much observed unto the Lord. A night to be much observed. Everybody say much observed. That's the old King James word. Remember it. Mark it. Pay attention to it. Mark it off. Why? You know what it speaks of? It speaks of our salvation. Coming out, have you properly observed that in your life? Have you properly marked that off? The day I was lost, we sang Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. Right? That what? Saved a what? Wretch. Now, wait a minute. Do you believe that? You gotta be desperate to believe you were a wretch. Y'all don't believe it. Y'all don't believe it. We sang it, but we don't. If I walked up to you and said, you wretch, you want to fight. If you heard Kenny Grant call you a wretch, you talking to some friends, you say, you know, I heard Kenny Grant over talking, and I overheard him call you a wretch. What? Yeah. We don't believe it. Right? But have we, I once was lost. That's a, you're talking about four letter words. That's one of the saddest words in the Bible. Lost. People are lost. People need a Savior. They're lost. You were lost. And God saved you. Observe that. Mark that off. Talk about it. Remember it. Keep your memory green about that. I was lost. I'm found. Was blind, I can see. Was damned, now I'm saved. That's enough to shout about. He said, hey, observe this. It's to be much observed. Pay attention to that. Mark it off. That's why we have communion. That's why we do communion. We remember his body and his blood. Remember it. Remember it. Keep your memory green. Don't forget it. Don't let it fade from vivid colors of reality to pastels to black and white to nothing. Don't remember. Keep it vivid. That's why he's woven right into the fabric of our faith, this communion that we do. This do ye in what? Remembrance of me. Keep your memory green. Observe it. Observe it. Observe it. It's to be much observed. They were never to forget this. Egypt, even today, Israel, even today, they have this. And the rabbi came and talked to them. They have it. And they go through, they mark, go through all of these rituals. Why do they do that? To observe that. They don't fully understand. Blindness has happened and they don't fully understand why they do it all. Right? And the fuller revelation of it, like you and I are blessed to have. They don't understand it. They hadn't embraced it all. We understand what it means symbolically and we know what it means substantively, what the reality of it is. Christ. And it's meant for soul salvation, not just bringing out a nation, but bringing out a soul. It's a night. You remember the dark night of your soul? You remember that? Have you marked that out? To be much observed. All the children of Israel in their generation. And the Lord said unto Moses and Aaron, this is the ordinance of the Passover, verse 43. There shall no stranger eat thereof. Now watch, he's talking about this Passover meal. He said, don't let strangers eat of it. But there's an asterisk that we're going to observe. Said, this is just for you. You know what he's saying? He said, this is really for saved people. Those who've come out of Egypt, those who identify with God and have faith in him. So the strangers can't do it. Now watch this. He goes on and put an asterisk by it. He says, a foreigner and a hired servant shall not eat thereof. In one house shall it be eaten. Thou shalt not carry forth aught of it, any of it, any of the flesh abroad out of the house, neither shall ye break a bone of it. By the way, talking about that lamb, who does that lamb picture? Everything, the whole book is about the lamb. Remember I told you, Genesis 22, where is the lamb? Question about Jesus. Isaac asked his daddy, where's the lamb? Son, the Lord will provide himself a sacrifice. The Lord got a lamb. Where is the lamb? John 1, 29, behold the lamb. There he is, the long-awaited one. Examine, behold him, look at him. There he is, examine him. Revelation 5, what? Worthy is the Lamb, the one who died, bled, his blood was shed to redeem us. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your old life and the traditions received from your fathers, but by the incorruptible blood of Christ is of a Lamb without blemish and without spot. Worthy is that lamb. So this lamb here pictures Christ. And the Bible says about that lamb, not a bone of him shall be broken. Right? Of course, in John chapter number 19, y'all remember that? Jesus is stretched wide on the cross. The Jews had a problem. Man, here we got the Sabbath is coming on. And we need this thing to get rushed on. They were crucified. So they said, hey, break the bones. Break the legs. So that what? They can die. Right. Why did they break the legs? They suffocate, right? They couldn't push up to breathe. And so they die of suffocation. They came to one, hit this thief, they broke his legs. Came to the other thief, broke his leg. But Jesus was dead already. They didn't break his leg. Not one bone broken. Right? The Bible speaks of that in John chapter number 19. Right? So you write that down. 19:36. Also, Psalm 34:20 speaks of that lamb, that not a bone of him would be broken. Psalm 34. And the Bible says over in John chapter number 19, when they came to Jesus and they didn't break his leg, said that the scriptures might be fulfilled. What scriptures? Psalm 34, but beyond that, Exodus chapter number 12. Because Jesus Christ is that lamb. See? How many of y'all know a man didn't write this book? This is God's book. And the Bible says, all the congregation of Israel shall keep it. Now notice this. Here's the asterisk. God says a foreigner, stranger can't do it. They can't eat of it. That is, this belongs to people who believe. This is a covenant people, right? Now notice, and when a stranger shall sojourn with thee. Now he's talking about the foreigner. Here's the asterisk. If a stranger shall sojourn with thee and will keep the Passover to the Lord, right? It wasn't just a ritual. It was all what? This was worship. This was what? To the Lord. Do you know that the communion that we take is worship? It's to the Lord, right? In fact, it is worship in such a way that where others are excluded, it is for us, but the Bible says as often as we do it, we do show forth. Show to who? To the world. That this is what we believe. We believe this stuff. When we take that Lord's Supper, we're saying we believe, we're witnessing, and we're worshiping. Right? And so even so with this Passover meal, he says, if a stranger shall sojourn with thee and will keep the Passover of the Lord, that is, he has willfully joined the covenant people, whosoever will, let him come. If he will, he will keep the Passover to the Lord, to Jehovah. That is, submit to the name, the person, the God, the Lordship of Jehovah. Let all his males be what? Circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it. And he shall be as one that is born in the land. Hey, so was God saying everybody stay out? No, he said anybody can come. But there's a way to come. Right? There's a way to come. And so God says, hey, they can come, but if they come, they have to believe. What's proof of their belief? He says, have all their males circumcised. You know what that means? They got to have a little skin in it. You know, hey, no easy believism. No, you got to come God's way. Right? Hey, I tell you, God will meet you on your turf, but you got to meet him on his terms. Or else you cannot come. Let me say it again. God will meet a man on his turf. Jesus went to where people were. He went to where people were as a man, a demon-possessed man on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, trapped off in the tombs. Nobody would be bothered. Half the people were scared of him. Jesus went to him. Made it right on his turf, tore up from the floor up. This man could not possibly have made himself. He was deranged, could not possibly have made himself, worked himself to God. So Jesus went to where he was. By his grace, saved this man. Yeah. The idea is, listen, God will come to where you are. He'll meet you in your stupor. It's an amazing thing about Billy Sunday. Many people didn't like Billy Sunday, but Billy Sunday was one of he was the Billy Graham of his day. He had been an ex-baseball player, and when he heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was drunk. Sort of sobered him up. He was carousing with his friends, and he heard the gospel And God spoke to him in that state. You know what that says? God came the way he was. There's been more than one person been saved in a bar stool. Realize there ain't no answers down in the bottom of this jug. There have been people who've walked away from a brothel right in the middle of that junk and got saved because there ain't nothing there that satisfied a soul. How'd they do that? The Spirit of God met them there. But everybody who comes must come on his terms. You ain't going to do an end run around Jesus and come. And so he talks about circumcision. And Paul, like I said, just like he does with the issue of unleavened bread, and he likens that to us putting away sin in our lives, he does the same thing with circumcision. Colossians chapter number 2. In verse number 11, the Bible says that everybody who's come to Christ has gone through a spiritual circumcision. Right? This foreskin speaks of the flesh. The seed of every man passes that way. And so when God gave to Abraham back in Genesis 17, this symbol, sign of his covenant of circumcision, we understand now later in the New Testament, because the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed, we understand that for us, substantively, spiritually, that's a symbol of our cutting off of the flesh. We have been cut off in the flesh. We are not in the flesh, we're in the spirit. We are a new people. Turn over to Colossians. We're going to close with this. Now, we'll Colossians chapter number 2. I love verse number 10. Well, I love that whole passage over in Colossians where it's really talk about the headship of Christ in the book of Colossians. All right, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. All right, I give you where that is, all right? Over there where those clean pages are in your New Testament. So... Well, Colossians, I know, but anyhow, look at what he says here in chapter number 2. Verse number 9, talking about Jesus. The Bible says, for in him, that's Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Do y'all realize that? Jesus is God of very God, right? Right. Now notice verse 10. And ye are complete in him. He makes us complete. Right. Who is the head of all principality and power. Jesus is the head of all principality and power. Notice. In whom also ye are, watch, circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. That is, it is not a fleshly circumcision. But the Bible says we are circumcised. See that? You are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands in putting off the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. That verse says that when we came to Christ, we were circumcised. The flesh was cut off, and we are put away the flesh. We are people in the spirit. See that? So that reflects back, even back to, that's why we study the book of Exodus again now as I close. We study the book of Exodus because it is freighted with illustrations of our so great salvation. That's my point. I don't have the ability to adequately point it all out. I'm just trying to like come through. It's like a picture book of so many things that we believe doctrinally. And so none of us have the ability to really, you know, fathom its depths. But there are some sterling and startling pictures of our so great salvation and illustrations that we stop and observe. So that here in Exodus chapter number 12 is a picture of our spiritual circumcision. Circumcision not with hands and a knife, but a spiritual circumcision. Hey, gang, let me say before I pray, go to the website. Please sign up. All right? Do that for your wives. Do that for your wife now. And man up, bring her out there, and you'll be a hero in her sight. She's the one who's always wanting to, let's do this, let's go to this conference. In fact, my wife and I are going to a marriage conference, and Shirley and I, let me tell you this, 39 years, you can imagine, in 39 years, we've had our scuffles, we had some issues. You can't raise four youngers and be mad 39 years, not have disagreements, right? And not have some dry patches. You're going to have them. You're going to have trouble. Question is, what are you going to do with trouble? Right? So I'm giving you permission. I want you to understand this. Shirley and I have had our share of our issues. Just like you. Just like you. We've gone to counselors. Hope you'll do that. I hope you'll man up to do that sometime. Hope you'll even take the initiative to do it. But we've had to go to counselors. Your car needs tuning up. Your marriage needs tuning up. Right? You work on your golf swing, work on your marriage. Really? You work on casting, you work on, you know how to cast your reel, your rod and reel, you know how to cast. You know why? You worked on it. Work on your marriage. I'm not here because I got it all together. I'm just saying it's worth working on. And marriages that I'm letting you go now. I know we're 2 minutes over right now. But marriages like that too, any mechanics in here, you know you have some wild, some crazy looking tools in a mechanic shop that's built for one thing, to get at some valve. Or get at something that nothing else can get to. You can't get to it with a crescent wrench or some box that you got. It's made specifically for that. Marriage is that tool made specifically to help you be what you could not be apart from marriage. To get at that thing that nothing else can quite get at in you. Your boss can't get at it. Your children can't get at it. Your grandyoungins can't get at it. Your neighbors can't get at it. But your wife can. Yeah, that's what I'm just telling you guys. So, hey, please, guys, go. And let's be a band of brothers. It's us. We need to do this, and we need to say, hey, listen, we're serious. And while we got a long way to go, we begin to take this step. And listen, don't be looking down your nose at people who have problems in their marriage. We are all strugglers. We all have dry patches. The guy who's talking to you every Friday has dry patches. Amen. Don't be surprised by that. Understand that. Amen. But what are we going to do with it? That's why we come here. Just be real. Time for us to be real. Father, thank you so much for meeting with us. Thank you for blessing these guys with their wives and their children and their grandchildren, and blessing us with the opportunity to make things right, to get them right, to make them right, to move towards you in every area of our lives, Lord. If it's broken, God, give us grace and wisdom and courage. Courage, God. Help us to be lion-hearted men. I mean, courageous enough to interface with our wives. Perhaps as much courage is needed there than anything we'll need today. Courage to interface with our wives. And so help us. Thank you that you will. Thank you for every man here. Thank you for your word, for your spirit. Dismiss us with your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
just been perfect men, a broken host of sinners made whole again. We praise you for your mercy, thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers, lead us in this